All we can do is try our best and then let the chips fall wherever they may. So this is about simply what we're doing here. And trusting it. Trust it. I just trust it. That's the key, is trust it. We're getting great help, so trust the great Dharma kings. Trust that they know what they're doing. They know we're going to succeed. They know we've already succeeded. And so we just continue to do the best we can. I had a real rough day, couldn't seem to get my thoughts going, but it's just a wow. It's a wow reaction is all it is. I know that. And so I'll bounce back from that. This is 2 steps forward, 1 step back. This is how it happens. So now, came across a really great quote from Nisargadatta Maharaj, and he says, "I am not here to produce devotees. I am here to produce gurus." And it just struck me what he was saying, and then this is just reverberated, and it's just like, wow, astonishing. We continuously harp here and nag on this. I talk about the spiritualization, spiritual materialism, the conceptual spiritualization of concepts. I call it the yoga girl thing. And it could be yoga guy, you know, but the yoga girls tend to be better at spiritualizing concepts at this time. What they're doing, what this means is producing professional devotees. Professional devotees. Apostles, devotees, professional. I'm so devoted, I'm so devoted, I'm so devoted. This is not realization. Okay, what we want is we want to be gurus. We want to be realized. We don't want to be professional devotees. That's terrible. That's stuck in duality. Absolutely stuck in duality. And I realize that, like on Facebook, everybody's trying, they're all devotees. Where's the guru-ness? Who's trying to be a guru? Who's actually saying, "I'm going to be a guru. I'm going to be enlightened. This is what I'm going to do." Okay, so this is the trouble here, is the world is going to put a cap on religion, spirituality, a cap on it, and say, the highest you can get is to be a devotee, a real good devotee. Spiritualize concepts, that's it. This is not true at all. When we release all thoughts, all concepts, as intrinsic spaciousness, this is called described as samsara being released into nirvana. Samsara being released into nirvana, something like that, is this is the vision of intrinsic spaciousness. At that point, we are a guru, so to speak. Now, we're not a Dharma king. Okay, we are not a Dharma king. A Dharma king is those who have the greatest capacity to attract others to guruhood, to liberation. And they're extraordinary in that way. Padmasambhava would be an example of a Dharma king. He's started Tibetan Buddhism, one of the main figures starting it, let's say. Tremendous capacity to attract others to enlightenment. But there have been many gurus in the world, like in Tibetan Buddhism. There are many masters, many gurus. Not all of them are Dharma kings. That's the very tippy top of profound attractiveness. It's just, you know, a massive magnet attracting the iron filings. But we can certainly be gurus. A precursor to being a guru is like a Dharma prince, is someone who is definitely going in the right direction with the right momentum and doing the right preparation to be a guru. Okay, absolutely. We most certainly can be gurus. That is what we're called to. We're not called to be professional devotees forever. And the world, this planet has a big problem with this. And quite frankly, I could say a lot about this, and I don't know how good it would go down. Yeah, I have to wash it down with something. It's just like, wow. But it's never about being a devotee. It's always about being accepting that you are a guru. You are liberated, already liberated in the now. And I look back and I say, oh my gosh, there's this whole false spirituality in the world that is attracting everyone to just be a devotee, and that's it. That's the highest you can go. And it's sex saying, oh, you can't be like Jesus. There's only one Jesus. Jesus is God. I mean, you're just a human being. So, in other words, you have to just be a devotee. You can never be like Jesus, even though Jesus' whole point was to say, yes, you can. I'm calling all of you to be just like me. He's very explicit about it. But in this world, what you have is just professional devoteeness. And then you try to say that you want to be like Jesus, and they say, you're a nut. You're crazy. You can't do that. You're evil. You're bad. No, they're the ones who are being described by their own words, actually. It's the ego that tells us that we, what we really are, the highest we can be is professional devotees, stuck in hope and fear and reward and purpose and duality. This is arrogance. It's absolutely, God created all of us equal. How could anyone possibly say that we're not equal to Jesus? Jesus said we're equal to Jesus. Okay. The Dharma kings say that we're equal to them. That's all they say. We are equal to us, exactly equal to us. But because of your continuity fear, it'll take you a while to accept this. First, you know, you work on the path as a pilgrim, and then you go from that to a Dharma prince, and then a guru, and then ultimately a Dharma king. So we're pilgrims, pilgriming towards being a guru, being enlightened, being liberated, towards the vision of oneness. So this is what we're all doing here. We're not stalling out into professional devoteeness. And I've said that there's an extreme imbalance in the world with too much feminine energy in terms of authority. The feminine energy always has the higher authority in this world because of mother. Okay, so my cousin is in a coma in a hospital, and they're meeting. She's a powerful matriarch, and they're meeting to decide whether to pull the plug on her life support, and they don't think she's going to make it. This is very shocking, to say the least. She was a very, very powerful matriarch, very wealthy, very powerful, and to see that just, you know, disappear like that. You know, I can't even put it into words at this point. But this is normal. People don't even, you know, most of the power in the world is vested in the mother and the grandmothers and the aunts, and they have a tremendous say. In ultimately, they basically say, no, you can be a devotee, but that's as high as you can go. That's what they generally, this is where it's coming from, actually. Virgin Mary, really the way she's being utilized in the world is to say, no, you can't be my son. My son is God, but you can be a devotee of my son. No, this is the Antichrist, I have to say. This is the ego saying that. And, you know, I don't think the real Virgin Mary is saying that at all. But the ego, to sell this lie, tries to use the most convincing mode that it can. So, we are never called to be, hold on, I'm getting a reaction from this. My vocal cords and breathing is being interfered with. Wow, like an allergic reaction suddenly struck my... So I just said something that is almost virtually unsayable here. This is what happens. But it's absolutely true. Just a moment. The worst thing you can be is a professional devotee, and that's where this New World Order is capping religion. It's going to cap it there, okay? They're not only going to cap carbon, they're going to cap religion. And these yoga girls are heavily, heavily investing in this and promulgating this and pushing this notion. And the spirituality that in the world now is really not going to get you to guruhood, no, Buddhahood, Buddha mind, not really. It lacks the male energy, the push, the determination, the adamant, the fire, and desperation. It lacks the desperation. You hear of those who have reached Buddhahood, Buddha mind, and their lives, you know, amazing that they're just so desperate and so adamant and are extraordinary spiritual athletes, and that this is what has to take place. But now it's over feminized, really. The whole spiritual scene is way over feminized now. It's, you know, no, you know, you can just do it in the night, you know, and it blinds us to the real path. It blinds us to the real path. You can have your cake and eat it too. So we have to bring back this adamancy, this very determined desperation. You have to bring that back. The last thing you want to do is turn into a professional devotee. That's terrible. You have to be the guru. You have to be the guru. We all have to be the guru. So, they're going to cap everything in this world, right? They're going to cap you so you turn into a robot. If they cap you as a professional devotee, well, a robot can be a professional devotee. Can it not? Absolutely it can. You can program all that. But a robot can never be a guru. Never. Could never realize Buddha mind. It's impossible. Just wow, everything that's being said, that's all. So any teacher that comes here and says you can never be as good as me, you know, they're lying. They're the ego. They're speaking from the egoic Antichrist dualistic standpoint, no matter what their rhetoric, non-dual rhetoric may be. They're trying to trap you into just being a devotee forever. And this is the worst thing possible. And there have been some those recently in the 70s, 80s, 90s, and in the recent decades who have done just that. I don't want to mention names, but if the shoe fits, you know what I'm talking about. they say they're the greatest guru ever, and you can never reach what they are, but you can be this eternal devotee who's constantly, you know. No, that's the worst message possible. Okay, and so this has been spiritualized. This message has been spiritualized as if this is really, you know, great, profound message. It's the totally wrong emphasis, completely wrong emphasis. Complete lie, wrong emphasis. Nothing right about it, actually, but yet it can be presented in a spiritualized way. And it has. And this has intimidated us, actually. There's actually only the oneness, and everything is it. All is it. God did not create anything greater than something else. There's the allness. And so, pragmatically, the Dharma kings have this great attractive power within the plan of God's plan of salvation. This is how it works. But in no way, in reality, are they any the slightest bit greater than any of the rest of us. None of us are higher or lower, actually. So, great damage is done in this world in terms of those gurus who do this. They're working for the yoga girls. They're working to spiritualize concepts. They're working to entrap you in devoteehood. And this causes a ripple down effect where we all feel like we're trapped. Jesus washed the feet of his disciples and apostles. His purpose was to make them realize that they were the same as him. We're all one. We're all one in truth. We're all one in truth. Greater things than these you shall do. Now, this whole thing about the matriarchy and this shocking thing what happens with that's going on with my cousin, my first cousin, being this symbol of the matriarchy, traditional matriarchy, suddenly just going into town to get some supplies at the grocery store, apparently, something like that, just driving along the highway and suddenly swerves, overcorrected, flipped the car, went off the road, down into a gully, and sustained these traumatic brain injuries, and boom, just like that. You see how unexpected something can strike in this world, how unexpected and just suddenly something strikes like this that just takes everyone just shocked. They just can't believe it. It's just a sudden extreme tragedy. Well, this is just an example of what has happened in this world over and over and over and over again. So we are called to guruhood here, okay. It's the professional disciples that are in trouble here. Big trouble. And that's the whole purpose. To trying to cap the whole situation here. There's some gurus who came into this world, some worse than others, who tried to cap the whole situation and says, you can't ever really really reach what you really are. They said, I'm already that, and you can't be that. This was like capping. It was like a reptilian plot, actually, to cap the world. There were some gurus who came in this world who were really reptilians. Heavily into, and you could tell the ones that were heavily into sex, drugs, and rock and roll as part of their thing, their guru-ness, okay. They were reptilians. And they came to cap this world by saying, the highest you can get is a devotee. Well, that totally plays into the reptilians' plan for this planet. Because they'll present themselves as intrinsically higher than us, and there's nothing we can do about it. It's kind of like slavery, right? I mean, you tell the slaves, look, we're intrinsically better than you. That's funny. The world rejects that now, totally, and yet it accepts the reptilians. It accepts the capping of religion. It's just utterly hypocritical. It is ridiculous. It's like they protest all day long. They protest. Oh, I hate black cars. I'll never drive a black car or a green car, whatever you want to say. The green car, so use green car. I hate green cars. I'll never drive a green car. No. And you look in the driver, and they're driving a green car. I say, what are you talking about? No, I hate green cars, but your car's green. No, I hate green cars. And it's just, it's like bizarre. One hand doesn't know what the other one's doing. So, by capping our spiritual aspiration, we've accepted slavery. Easily now we're manipulable. How do you say that? Manipulable. We're capable. We're easily manipulated. I don't know if there's a if we can say it that manipulable. No, it doesn't work, does it? Okay, we're easily manipulated. But those who, are going towards guruhood are not easily manipulated, which is why those taking over this planet worked so hard to cap this and distorting Jesus and making an idol out of him to turn us all into devotees instead of masters, instead of saviors. We're all actually saviors. Jesus calls us to be saviors. He, in the Course of Miracles, he says, "I'm calling you to be saviors of the world, or saviors of yourself from the world. I'm calling you to be saviors. I'm not calling you to make an idol out of me and worship me and idolize me." It's utterly that's totally opposite of what I'm doing. So, when Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro came to me in a dream, he didn't come to me like this in some flowing gown, with all sorts of paraphernalia on and wait for me to get on my knees and bow in front of him or something. Just the opposite. He came with open arms like this. Like, give me a hug, and insisted that, that I stay equal with him. He insisted on it. I was like, really? You're kidding me? Really? He grabbed me, and he's not going to let me bow to him or get on the ground or do anything like that. It was very decisive on his part, the way he approached me. Now, that doesn't mean I'm better than anyone else. It just means that I've worked on realizing that we're all equal, actually. So he says, I know, he was saying, look, I know you can get this, that we're all one in spirit here. And Jesus came back in last May, early May, I believe. It was early May. And he said, I'm back, and I've come back to relate with all of you as just a friend. As a friend. That's it. That's all he said. In other words, equality. 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 That's all he said. That's all. So that's it. That's Jesus. I'm back, and I'm here to relate with all of you as a friend. People bristle at any mention that that they say, no, Jesus is God. You can't be like Jesus. No. Well, then if you're not the same as Jesus, then you're a weapons manufacturer, plain and simple. So if someone asks you, well, why did you decide to be enlightened? Well, I got tired of being a weapons manufacturer, because you're either enlightened or you're a weapons manufacturer. That's it. It's the only two roles there are for us. If we reject our true role that God created us as, then we will be a weapons manufacturer, manufacturing hope as a weapon against God. It doesn't have any effect on God, so it's nothing at all. But we will be in that role, plain and simple. And there's no other role. There's no other role. The ego keeps trying to invent these roles for us, telling us that there's other roles. No, there is not any other role. You either accept truth or you're denying truth. And if you deny truth, to try and get rid of your fear, you try to figure out a way to attack truth. And denial of truth is really trying to change truth. And so you're trying to manufacture weapons to change truth, which the weapon is hope. So again, someone asks, well, why are you enlightened? Because I got tired of being a weapons manufacturer, working in a weapons factory, which is this planet's just a weapon factory. That's all that it is. Got tired of working in a weapons factory, manufacturing the weapon of hope. I just feel like I can do better than that. I want to be on a different trip, a better trip, more intense trip. This is just boring. It's boring. It's boring. It's boring. It's boring. This day is boring. It's very boring, isn't it? What, manufacturing a useless weapon that can never be used and has no effect? Isn't that kind of boring? I find it very boring. This summer, again, it's being pointed out, it was pointed out to me today, the troubles that are coming. And there's a lot of troubles coming. A lot of mental agitation. Being a devotee is not good enough. A Dharma prince is different than a devotee. This is someone that a guru is a protege of a guru. Your protege, be a protege, meaning you're headed for guruhood. So you have to extricate yourself from discipleness, from devoteeness, because that's an entire mindset, actually, dualistic mindset. You must extricate yourself from that. This is what we're doing here. And Nisargadatta would bellow at his students, and glare at them, and because the questions they ask, that they're just trying to be devotees. Hey Maharaj, how can I be a better devotee? He'd scream at him, I'm not here to develop devotees. I'm here to develop gurus. I don't want devotees. I want gurus. I'm not in the devotee business. I'm in the guru business. Yeah, that's what his guru was in, right? He was in the guru business, and Maharaj turned into be a guru. Because that's the business. The business of the spiritual path is to succeed. Not to idolize, but to succeed. It's so easy these days. California passed the assisted suicide law. So people, now they get sick, now I'm getting old. Oh, okay. Let's pull the plug. Pull the plug. We're a pull the plug society. The society is revolting in every which way right now. We forget Jesus raised people from the dead, cured it, cured everything. Any affliction we have, he cured it. Simply because the faith he instilled in others, that they were just like him. And then they remembered, oh yeah, this is just all a silly pretense here. I don't, this is just my weapons manufacturing, pretense. I'm supposed to get sick. I'm supposed to evolve. I'm supposed to die. Oh, yeah, I'm supposed to do that. So our time here is spent towards guruhood, actually. Buddha mind, Christ mind, vision of Christ, vision of oneness. Nothing other than that. So it's your path, your path. You're the guru. You're going to be a guru for sure. So be one now. That's all we're saying. We're all working together to so that we are the gurus. You know, it's our time to be the gurus now. And to tell everybody else they can be equal to us. And to get rid of that cap that has been so, you know, maliciously placed here. And every one of you can be a guru, can be liberated, can be a world savior. Absolutely. Absolutely. Nothing's actually in the way at all except continuity fear. It's all that's in the way. Just your continuity fear. Nothing else is in the way. So we just continue to evaporate this continuity fear. Again, the only thing that stands in the way of if all of us from being, you know, all of us being world saviors, liberated from duality, is our own continuity fear. That's all that's standing in the way. Now, of course, the collective continuity fears, just all our own continuity fears, reinforcing one another. But ultimately, we have the power to evaporate our own continuity fear. Okay? And nobody can stop us from doing that, actually. And we do it, the most powerful way is just to be quiet, but intensely quiet, intensely in the wow, full stop in the wow. You feel that I'm about to do it, and you wow that, you feel it. You feel the willingness, and then you wow the willingness. You don't accept it or reject it, just wow it. This is the whole key to the whole situation. Don't accept or reject, just wow it. Someone told me an interesting story today. Speaking of comas, they said that their relative was in a coma for 6 months, an induced coma for 6 months. And they finally took her out of it. And she woke right up. And then she goes, "Where am I? What is this?" And then they immediately put her back into it. Because they said she was overstimulated and it was too shocking. So you have to bring her out gradually. Reduce the medicine gradually. So you kind of go into a twilight state first and kind of then hazy, then kind of like you start noticing a little something. What is this? And they gradually brought out, and now she's fine. So we come out of our spiritual coma. We wow it. We don't say, "Oh, what is this? What is this?" But we just stay in the wow. Whatever we're experiencing, just stay in the wow. Wow, even if it's abidance in what is, just wow, wow. So you realize, "Oh, I can open my eyes." Do you open your eyes right away? No. You say, "Okay, wow, I can open my eyes. Wow, I can be enlightened. I can be enlightened. Okay, wow." Don't try to grab enlightenment. Don't try to force it. Don't try to eagerly accept it. And don't try to reject it. Say just, "Wow, I can be enlightened." Okay? Or, "Wow, I'm already enlightened. I already have the capacity. I'm already there. I'm already there. I'm already here. That's an even better way to put it. I'm already here. Just say, wow, I'm already here. So this is the path of to be a guru, not a devotee. A devotee will say, no, you're up there and I'm down here, and I'm very aware of that, and I can tell the difference, and this is where I have to be, and this is where you have to. That's the devotee. No, we say, I'm already here. I'm aware I'm already here. Wow. So we use this already-ness and the wow. I'm already here. There's nothing I need to do. There's nothing I need to do to be where I am. There's nothing I need to do to be I am. There's nothing I need to do to be I am. There's nothing I need to do to be I am. Nothing I need to do to be I am. Just wow this. Okay. See, the wow, you don't go into devotee status in the wow. You refuse. You don't advance. You don't retreat either. You don't retreat into devotee-ness, conceptualizing it, your situation. Okay, I know where I stand. But no, don't conceptualize it. Just wow it. See, the devotee has hope that they can one day be a guru. Hope. That's what generates hope. But it's the professional hope generators. They never practice what we need to practice to evaporate the continuity fear. They just think they have to get lucky some eventually, which, of course, luck has nothing to do with it. So they just teach everybody to generate hope. The religions become religions of hope. Those are false religions. The true religions are religions of realization, not of hope. Religions of realization that you are going to be realized. You're already realized, actually. You are already realized. All of us are already realized. There's nothing that has to be added to us to be realized at all. So when you come into this world, you try to teach guru-ness, people assault you. You just say, no, you're crazy. You can only be a devotee. What are you, some egomaniac? You can't be as good as Jesus. Come on. They're speaking the words of the ego. There's nothing that we need added to us to be realized. Nothing we need that needs to be added to us at all to be where we already are, be I am. I am here. There's nowhere we have to go whatsoever to get us where we already are. So we're into July now. The days will speed by. And take all this to heart. And just trust it. Trust in yourself. Trust in your... There's nothing you need to add to get realized. You don't need to do anything to get realized, to add anything. We just need to drop the continuity fear. What is this? This is unusual to get a text at this time, so... Well, it's about my cousin. I'll respond in a minute here. When we're... they're deciding, meeting to decide whether to pull the plug or not. Well, someone's decided to pull the plug on all of us already, you know? And, I don't, you know, someone had, we, our continuity fear is such that we welcome those who would cap us at devoteehood. We elect them as president. We allow the reptilians to come into this world to get in positions of power. And they say, don't worry, we'll cap you. You know, you're all capped. You can never be as great as we are. We say, oh, thank you. We're so nervous, and we don't know why we're so scared. It's called continuity fear, folks. It's evaporatable. That's the whole spiritual path, is to evaporate your continuity fear. They're not even trying the spiritual path. Most people in this world don't even try it at all. They just immediately go running for a big, you know, for mom. Hey, mom, you know, I can never be as good as you. I can never be as great as you. Tell me, I'm just a, you know, I can never be that. You know, we're afraid of reality, of our freedom, because we've been trying to attack it for so long. But we have to be aware of this. Our problem is the continuity fear. As I was in 1978, the Holy Spirit showed me. I woke up for a moment. I was enlightened, and then I started to lose it. And I say, "What's going on?" I was aware that it's a continuity fear, and the Holy Spirit said, "Don't worry. You'll get back to it. You just have to evaporate this continuity fear. You just have to work on it. We'll work on it together." The Holy Spirit said, "And you'll get back to this." So I said, "So I believed that. I saw it. I said, okay, you're right. And now I know exactly what needs to be done." It's just evaporate our continuity fear. It's all that needs to be done. We don't need the reptilians in this planet. We don't need them to be ruling us. We don't need their bureaucracy. We don't need their laws and regulations. We don't need them at all. We can have a society based on evaporating our continuity fear and have laws, rules, regulations, culture around that central theme. It's a no-brainer. Of course, this is what we need to do. So... it's not like we're lacking understanding what needs to be done. It's very cut and dried, very simple. Very, very simple. And as I've said, that we... with the willingness to just keep working to evaporate our continuity fear, we're going to be gurus. This is our aim, nothing other than that. Well, you know what? With those dance moves, those spiritual dance moves that we have, you know, we may just attract another dance partner other than this world, actually. You know that? We might have a world that loves us so much as, so I just love that attitude you have of guruhood or bust. You know, that's it. You know, you and evaporating your continuity fear, and I just love that. I want to totally support that as a dwelling place. And we may just have this world just dance right into our lives. Actually, it may just dance right into our lives. And it may cut in on this world and say, hey, tap it on the shoulder and say, hey, I'm gonna dance with us now. you can go sit on the sidelines. Cut in, just cut in on our world and be our new dance partner. Just like that. And so we say, wow, we're now dancing, and it's, oh, this is so much better. Before it's like we're fighting the dance partner, but now it's smooth. We say, oh, that's great. So it really could be seen like that. It is, we think we have to go to another world or something. No, it's very likely the other world will come to us. Very likely the other world will come to us. Because here, too many have called the reptilians in and allowed them to come in and to cap religion, cap religious aspiration. Just give us spiritualized concepts, turn it all into idolatry and worshiping idolatry. Golden calf thing again. Spiritual materialism is what we have in the world now. And it's so rampant. You know, I don't see any way that percentage-wise, the world is going to turn away from it at this point. People are almost oblivious to that they need to be gurus. Actually, they just think, oh no. Now that, so their aim is now been lowered, been capped, and they've accepted because they feel that's how to get rid of my fear. No, that's how to keep your fear. Now, of course, when we're getting rid of our fear, we become more conscious of the fear because we're seeing, oh, it's leaving me, that's gone. So it may seem more acute, but it's being evaporated, and ultimately it's gone. And when we feel more complacent, like, okay, things are the way they're supposed to be, that's when we're keeping our fear. So we seem safe because we're keeping our fear. We're not going to wake up. And so, oh, okay, that seems safe. But really all we're doing is we're keeping our fear here in the world. They just decided, well, let's keep our continuity fear. Let's not evaporate it. So there may be another dwelling place that may just love our attitude of evaporating continuity fear and just say, wow, I wanted to. Can I support you? Do you mind if I support? Be like really supportive of you, and we'd say, yeah, sure, we love it, no problem. Be supportive of us. Jesus says that when we ask something of the universe, it's not like we have to force anything. He said just the opposite. The universe absolutely delights in responding to our every desire and whatever we ask of it. It just loves and delights in this. So we could easily be attracting another world. The universe might be saying, wow, boy, this attitude, we just love it. You know, evaporating continuity fear is all we have to do. There's only one problem everyone has, and it's just continuity fear. There's no other problem, plain and simple. There isn't. All of us have to do is simply evaporate our continuity fear. We don't need to do anything to be what we already are, to be where we already are, to be what we already are, to be realized. We just need to stop trying to do something to make us what we already are. Spaces of Allowance made some good comments, interesting comments. Like, it's like we're trying to turn on the radio; it's already on. And so we're trying so hard. I can't figure out how to turn on this radio. You know, it's just unbelievably. It's already on. We just need to stop trying to turn it on as if somehow we have to activate ourselves. No, God activated us. We're God activated. We don't activate ourselves. We're God realized. God realizes us. We don't have to realize ourselves. You know, we are realized. We are realized. We're already realized by God. We're trying to get the ego to realize us. We're trying to be ego realized. No, the ego's too late. We're already God realized. We're already God realized. So, yes, Just let this settle in now. Just let it settle in. And trust it. Trust it. We have Guru, the Guru, the Dharma Kings have our backs. This is what I know. They have our backs. So I just keep trusting it. We will be realized. We'll see that we already are realized. We will see this and accept it. We will accept that we are naturally realized. Naturally here. Naturally one. They say the most dangerous trips are the ones just going to the store around town. Most accidents happen a couple miles from your home, actually. When you're going on a trip, you're really focused. And, you know, you're a professional driver. But when you're just going out for somewhere, you may have your mind on 20 different things and really not be paying very much attention. This is, we all know this, right? That sometimes I take off driving and I keep thinking I'm like back in my house and suddenly I snap out of it and say, well, wait a minute, I'm driving. You know, I'm not even looking in the mirrors. I'm not, whoa, you know, what, come on. You know, I gotta, am I aware where the other cars are around me? Am I, where are the cars in front of me? And no, my mind is, you know, still back on the house and what do I need to get at the market? I'm thinking, what do I need to get at the market now? Did I forget anything? You know, we're not paying attention. So when you get in that car, spend some time before you start it up and start driving. And just tell yourself, hey, I'm a professional driver now. Check the mirrors, double check the mirrors. Okay, what are the other cars on the road? Okay, I want to notice the cars. I want to notice the pedestrians. I want to start seeing the pedestrians. Where are the pedestrians? Where are the cars? You know, where's everybody? Where's everything? And get your mind into driving mode. It's really important. I have to do that myself now. Now this is really a wake-up call. Yeah, just don't mail it in. And our life is the same way. We get up in the morning and say, hey, you know, I'm driving my spiritual vehicle today. What do I need to do spiritually today? Let me just not call it in. Let me really focus on it and do a super great job. I have to be a guru. There's no way around it. We all have to be world saviors. No way around it. So many are professional devotees, and it seems so much easier because they don't deal with their continuity fear. They just let it alone, and they say, okay, what kind of worship do you want? What kind of rituals do you want? How can I be a proper devotee? And they say, okay, that's good. That's it. They don't wake up, so they don't even deal with the continuity fear at all, really. No, they don't. This is what I've noticed. The continuity fear only arises when you decide to be a guru, to be a world savior, to wake up, to realize. That's when the continuity fear then suddenly emerges and surges like a tsunami. And you say, what the heck? So when you make this shift from devotee to realizer, you decide, I'm going to be a realizer this life, not a devotee. Then that's when the continuity fear, you become aware of it. And that's all it is. And then you say, okay, well, got to go to work on it now. This is my life's, you know, ambition, my life's work is to evaporate this continuity fear. So Facebook is a good example. I find it's very interesting that almost everyone are simply devotees. That's all. I'm one of the only people that actually say comment and say something. They all have stock responses, you know, that are just, you know, hey, I'm a great devotee of that, and I'm a great devotee of that, you know. And I try to say something, you know, different, like, hey, you know, this helps us be gurus, you know. This is how this can help us to be gurus. But this is not the etiquette on Facebook. There's really a strong etiquette that's unspoken etiquette because everyone thinks that is cap now. So anyone acting like it's not cap, they look like you're weird. That's kind of freaky, you know. That's why I say the freak is back. The freak is back. Meaning the truth is back, because the world thinks the truth is freaky. Well, you can't be like Jesus. That's crazy. What are you, some kind of freak? You want to be some kind of freak or something? No, come on. We're all devotees here. That's enough. That's good enough. God, that's what God wants us to be. No, God created us all perfectly equal, perfectly free. He didn't create us to be professional devotees of freedom. He created us as freedom. We are the freedom. We're not devotees of the freedom. We are the freedom. Now the matriarch is helpful. You can't, you know, this weapons manufacturing facility here requires the matriarchy to keep making bodies. It just has to be balanced. We need this guru energy, this male energy. It's much more, you know, direct, and we call it male energy because it tends to bifurcate along those lines. To see a matriarch just struck down like this, it's very sobering and somber and sobering and kind of, you know, shocking. It's not the end of all, because we have this guru energy now, you know, here. This Dharma Prince perspective and guru energy and determination. And so that doesn't depend on the mother or the matriarchy at all. Mother can be all things in the weapons factory, but she can't be enlightened for us, okay? We have to be enlightened. She can train us to be professional devotees, which is what she does, but that's not the right training. Meaning you're a good little weapons manufacturer and you think that God loves you for it. the concept idol god, you know, we're taught loves us for being good little weapons manufacturers. Of course they're going to claim that God wants us to do this. They probably got a framed picture of God on the wall of the weapons manufacturing facility. Chairman God, you know, is smiling, pleased, so pleased that you're really working, produce this weapon called hope. We don't have to do that. We don't have to do that at all. We don't have to keep doing that. What we call life is just a weapon, actually. We're trying to manufacture this weapon called life. We call it life. It's kind of an absurd name to give it. Its real purpose is to destroy life. And everybody says, hey, look, I'm destroyable. Therefore, reality must be destroyable. So we're all witnessing, impermanence witnesses to destroyability. We say, yeah, we're all destroyable. and just hear it. Just let it. Just get the. Let it evaporate your continuity fear. See, it's a very abstract thing. It's so important to understand. There's an evaporation Okay, not a figuring anything out. It's an evaporation of continuity fear. And when you do this, just then spontaneously, a breakthrough will just happen. Spontaneously. My breakthrough is just kind of just like a bubble suddenly coming to the surface. And poof. It's just, I'll suddenly just start having just sudden feel like, hey, I can look at, let me look at this, and wow, I see it like that. It just arises like a bubble to the surface. And that happens because of this work like this, a full stop in the wow. Don't try to make it happen. Don't try to figure it out. Just evaporate the continuity fear. Don't measure the evaporation. Don't try to label it. Don't try to dissect it, you know, catalog the evaporation. Evaporation is a very abstract term, isn't it? It's a puddle of water. It's evaporating. You don't see the evaporation. You don't notice the evaporation, but if you come back, you know, the next day, you realize, oh, you know, there's less there. It's like, so we are evaporating our continuity fear by not doing anything other than that. And so don't try to quantify it. Full stop in the wow. Just keep on keeping on, hearing the truth, kind of being shocked by it and wowed by it. And that evaporates our continuity fear. And evaporation takes a little time, doesn't it? So don't try to grasp it mentally. Because the shift happens just from a willingness standpoint, actually. It's not from a cognitive standpoint. It comes from a willingness standpoint. Where you have the will. You're willing to do so. And then automatically, from having the will, the willingness, the clarity dawns upon us, just like that. And the will is subjected right now to continuity fear. It uses continuity fear like an anchor. So I said, I don't want to float away, you know, so let me be anchored to continuity fear. We keep working on the anchor. We keep working on continuity fear, evaporating it. I wonder what's holding this balloon. Is it anchored properly? I guess it is. I don't know if it could fly away now, could it? Oh yeah, it could. It could still fly away. So, but you know, it's interesting. Losing the helium. It's like a balloon losing helium, till finally it'll just, like, when you let it go, it'll just kind of float right there. Doesn't go up, disappear, just floats. Yeah, like that vision of oneness. So we're just evaporating our continuity fear, trusting it. Evaporation works. I know it's difficult, might seem difficult to trust. Evaporation works. We know that in principle, don't we? That we can evaporate something, or let it evaporate. Let the paint dry, you know, it's evaporation. Evaporation is constantly taking place in this world, constantly. Well, just let the continuity fear evaporate when we subject it to the heat of this inquiry. Self-inquiry, the heat of inquiry evaporates our continuity fear, for sure. There's like a boiling water trying to reduce something, a pan. Just let it boil, 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 and it reduces. You get a thick sauce eventually. Evaporation, it just takes a while. You can't force it. You have the sauce that's too runny, you know. What could you do? You got to reduce it. So you just keep subjecting it to the heat and stirring it. That's all. That's all we're doing. We're just We're just keeping the heat on and then stirring it so it doesn't burn. And keep the heat high, though. See, there's two things we have to do. We have to stir it so it doesn't burn, and keep the heat high so it keeps evaporating. If we don't stir it, it'll burn, and if we turn the heat down, it won't evaporate. Evaporation will stop, you know. So we high heat and stirring it. If we have the high heat but don't stir it, that's like too much male energy. It would burn out. If we turn the heat down too far, that's like female energy. It doesn't evaporate. We become then professional devotees, because that seems like, well, that's all we can do. So it must seems almost natural to us that, yeah, we don't have, the heat's not high enough. So I always, you know, want to bring some heat to the videos, as well as quiet and calm, stirring it. Full stop and the wow, stir your sauce, and so it doesn't stick, you're just stirring it. And okay, then let it more evaporate like that. So if we just sit here, and the impact of what we're talking about, it's like boiling us. The conifer is evaporating from us, actually. And while we're doing this, we may not seem to be able to be so cognitively facile and speak of this and this and this and that. That's fine, because that's not our goal. Our goal is evaporate our continuity fair. And then automatically, we will recognize that we're already realized. And that there's nothing that we need to do to be what we are. We will realize there's nothing we need to do to be what we are, to be realized. There's nothing we need to do to be realized at all. We're already realized. It will dawn upon us. So the path is like an indirect one. You keep the heat on. You evaporate the continuity fear. Don't try to reach enlightenment. That's the wrong way. It's the wrong way. Then you're just creating a barrier. So just don't let enlightenment be as it is. Don't try to do anything with it. Just evaporate your continuity fear. And then it will just then naturally just dawn upon us. You know, just dawn upon us. This is the right way to go about it. And so many, you know, devotees, they're trying to just stay devotees. So how can I be a devotee of you if you don't explain to me, you know, how you did it, you know, and this, and these are questions of devotees. And they're completely off track. We don't need, the question is, how do I practice full stop and the wow? How can I keep practicing this? That should be the only question. How do I evaporate my continuity fear should be the only question. And it should just be pretty simple. Okay, well, you just practice full stop on the wild. Keep the heat on, hear truth, stir the pot so it doesn't burn, and just keep doing that in patience, and it's easily explained. But no, the devotee says, well, no, that won't help me stay a devotee. You know, how do I stay a devotee? You know, they say, how can I be a perfect devotee? That's an oxymoron if ever there was one, a perfect devotee. No. Be the guru. And the guru is already perfect. Be that which is already perfect. We are that. Devotees will say, "Well, we're not getting anywhere." Well, because they want their goals to be devotees. We don't care about being a devotee here. We care about evaporating our continuity fear. That's all we care about, and trusting it that this is what will work. I have breakthrough after breakthrough after breakthrough after breakthrough that just dawns upon me. It can happen any moment. Just dawn upon me, like, oh, now I see. Yeah, oh, I see the whole shift, whole paradigm shift. You know, the world's just a weapons manufacturing facility. That's all that it is. You know, just complete paradigm shift, like just like a bubble, just sort of boop right into the surface or something. And then, but I just stay grounded. I say, okay, now let me keep evaporating continuity fear around this realization and others to come. We don't have to remember what breakthroughs were. Just keep evaporating the continuity fear, and better ones will arrive, actually. Better ones will keep arriving. Clearer and clearer and clearer. And just trust the process like this. Trust the process. So, July, time for enlightenment here. Time for enlightenment. Just let it evaporate. See? When the wow is there, just put the heat on and we stay with it like this. And you can feel your whole psyche readjusting, kind of. Don't try to focus on any particular aspect of that readjustment at all. Just stay in the wow. Let it. Don't interfere with it. Don't interfere with your own success. Devotees are expert at interfering with their success. They're experts at it. They're expert saboteurs of their own success. They're constantly blocking themselves from enlightenment. But we stay out of our own way here. We don't try to depict what is evaporating anything in particular. It's just a general overall evaporation. Okay? Don't fixate on anything, any particular aspect of it. Don't fixate on it. Refuse to fixate. starting to get tired now. So, you can feel it. So when you feel that, sometimes you can push through it.